sing, whoa.
Praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have.
A new song for you this morning. It's called I've Witnessed It, and this song got me thinking of some things maybe that we've witnessed in our lives that we'll truly never forget, like the moment we got a first car, right? Or the moment that we graduated, the moment where we get our first paycheck, or the moment where we got married. Hopefully no spouses forget that today. or the moment that our child was born for some. Hopefully the dads don't forget that. I know there's one that the Vikings fans will never forget. Last year, when the Vikings came back against the Colts, 33-0, and they won the game. Any Vikings fans remember that one? Yes, it's like some people are like, oh, let's just forget that. Let's just move forward, hopefully. Yeah, RIP Kirk Cousins. But how about some moments where you, like when you, the first time you met Jesus and it changed your life forever? Or the moment where, you know, Jesus has walked through difficult seasons with you in your life, or the moments where you've seen his faithfulness and his goodness in your life. You know, there's a scripture in the book of, in Psalms, Psalm 77, verse 11, that says, it talks about how we're supposed to remember and ponder the great things that Jesus has done in our lives. And that's what this song declares. It says some great things about the goodness and the faithfulness and the love of Jesus and the times that we've witnessed it in our lives. And maybe you've walked in this room today and you've never experienced that. You've never experienced the goodness and the faithfulness of Jesus. Well, I just pray that the lyrics and the language of this song will help you see who Jesus can be and what he can do for you and your life today. Let's sing the song, I've Witnessed It. The lyrics are on the screen. You can sing along with us today.
You healing, I
thankful for all the many times that we've witnessed your faithfulness, your goodness in our lives. We're thankful that we can call you our constant. When other things shake around us, you are the firm foundation that we can stand upon today and know that if you've done it before, you can do it again and again. We're confident of it today. And I also pray over anyone that's walked in this room today, Lord, that's never seen that, Lord God. May you just open their eyes to see how good you are, and how faithful you are, and how great you are for us. We're thankful today, Jesus, for you. And we're thankful that we've been able to witness it up until now, and what you continue to do in our future. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, can we give Jesus some praise today? Yeah. Well, thanks for being with us today. Welcome to Westbridge again. Go ahead and take your seats. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Welcome, everybody, to Westbridge. Whether you are online or in person, thanks so much for joining us. My name is Amanda, and I'm a part of the communications team. If you're a first-time guest with us today, welcome. We're so glad you're here. On your way in, you may have taken a program. Inside, there are three things. First is an outline to help you follow along with today's talk. Next is a connection card. If you're a first-time guest, feel free to fill out as much information as you feel comfortable with. If you bring that card to the Next Steps area in the lobby, we have a t-shirt for you, just as our way of saying thanks for being here today. Last thing in the program is a giving envelope. If you'd like to give today, you can drop it in the giving station on the way out of the auditorium. You can also drop it in the mail anytime, postage paid. You can also give by text. Just text any dollar amount to 84321 to get started. All of this and more can also be found on the Church Center app. On April 28th, we are having Westbridge Worship Night. We'll celebrate baptism and communion together along with our favorite worship songs. And if you've never been baptized, this is a perfect time for you to do that. Check out westbridgechurch.com/events or click on events in the Church Center app to sign up for baptism or childcare that night. As we move to the next part of our service, we want you to know that Westbridge intentionally creates welcoming environments online and in person for everybody. So no matter what your relationship with God is or isn't, we are so glad you're here. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Good morning. Welcome to Westbridge Church. My name's Jeremiah. I'm one of the pastors here. It's awesome to have you with us today. I want to say hello to everybody joining us online. Thanks for participating through that venue. And if you're in a parent viewing room, that's a great option if you have small kids you prefer to keep with you during the service. And we are jumping into a brand new series today called The Road Less Stupid. So I'm pretty excited about that. I can tell you are too. And all of us have some decisions that we've made, and we look back and we go, that was really stupid of me. And so this is a series that's going to be all about wisdom in the different arenas of our life for the next several weeks. And here's the good news about this. This is not like, hey, you get to come here and learn about the wisdom of Jeremiah. All right? That is not this. I am a fellow traveler. I'm trying to figure this out just like you are. And the reason I'm so excited about this series is because when you speak from your weakness, you never run out of material. So we get to talk about stuff that I'm still figuring out and learning over the next several weeks. But here's something we all have in common, right? Most of us have lived long enough to reap the benefits of some good decisions that we've made or some good habits that we've developed. And most of us have also lived long enough to experience the consequences of some bad decisions that we've made or some bad habits that we've developed. And all of us have one of those things. And let's just kind of do a little mass confessional here real quick. If you have ever said something you wish you hadn't said, done something you wish you hadn't done, accepted an invitation you wish you hadn't accepted, or spent money you wish you hadn't spent, raise your hand. Okay, yeah, like 90% of us. The other 10% are lying in church. That's amazing. Okay, and here's what's amazing. We all have this, right? We all have these things. Consequently, we look back at our lives and we all have, I'm glad I did that, and we all have, I wish I hadn't. And every one of us could stand up here and tell a glad I did or wish I hadn't story this morning, right? All of us have those. And as we grow up, hopefully, we eventually learn that life is kind of connected. Like the decisions we're making today are shaping our tomorrow. The decisions that we're making today, it's a lesson every parent tries to get their kids to learn. It's what I want my kids to learn growing up, is that there is cause and effect, action, reaction. Like the decisions I'm making today actually have an impact on my future. That basically, and this is kind of a, gets maybe a little bit of hyperbole, but this is the reason that parents say this to their kids. As soon as they get into ninth grade, they say, these grades count, right? Up until that point, it's like, I don't know, nobody, eighth grade GPA is not really a thing, but like ninth grade, you're like, these ones count. And what you're saying to your kids is, you got to understand, like, the grades you're getting now, that can impact what kind of a school you get into, which can impact the kind of career you might have, which can impact the kind of people you might meet, which can kind of impact, like, who you marry, and it impacts your career and all this kind of things. And so, like, do good on that biology test today. Now, that's a bit of hyperbole, but you get the idea that life is connected. We want our teenagers to know the decisions I'm making today aren't just made in a vacuum. That it's not just, like, life is not static, life is fluid, and I make a decision today that actually sets the trajectory of my life. And this often gets overlooked, but the choices that we make today not only affect our tomorrow and build our tomorrow, they actually impact the tomorrows of the people that we love the most. They impact the tomorrows of the people around us that are closest to us in our lives. We are rarely happier than our relationships are healthy. And here's the most difficult part about all of this. The easiest person to deceive is the person in the mirror. The easiest person to fool is me. The easiest person for you to fool is you. I mean, when it comes to deceiving me, I'm the best. And when it comes to deceiving you, you're the best, right? And we have talked ourselves into, we have deceived ourselves into, we've sold ourselves on the worst ideas and the worst decisions that we've ever made, right? I mean, isn't it true? Of all of your bad decisions, you were there for all of them. And all of my bad decisions, I mean, I was there for every single one. I wasn't absent at any of those. And in most cases, and this is probably the most embarrassing part, we masterminded our own regrets. Like, we sold ourselves. You talked yourself into, you sold yourself on it. I talked myself into and sold myself on it, on what eventually became my biggest regret, whether it's financial or professional or academic or relational or something in your marriage or something with your parenting or something in your career or, you know, a friendship. We've all done things to undermine our own happiness. We've all made decisions that undermine our own success and our own progress, that undermine, we've done more to undermine our own success and our own progress and our own happiness than anyone else in our life has. We've done that to ourselves. And it's like there's this sales associate that lives in your mind, and their voice sounds a lot like yours. And the sales associate that lives in my mind, his voice sounds a lot like mine. And the sales associate in the head, you know, it's like we sell ourselves on decisions that we know aren't wise. But there's some sales associate in my head going, yeah, but have you thought about this? I mean, you could do this, come on. And here's what's crazy about this. If you were in a retail establishment, and there was a sales associate that tried to sell you on something using the exact same reasoning, you would be insulted. Because it's usually not very good reasoning. Usually it's like, come on, just go ahead and spend that money. I mean, you can always sell it later. Could you imagine if a sales associate tried to sell you that in a retail establishment? Like, just buy it. If you don't like it, you can just resell it later. You'd be like, that's not a good sales pitch. But we sell ourselves that way. And we go, yeah, that's a good point. And we justify it in our own minds. We make unwise decisions. We sell ourselves on it. And here's why we do this. We deceive ourselves into thinking that wisdom is all about getting information. If I can just gather all the most pertinent information, then I can make an informed decision. And that's wisdom. But the truth is, that's just information. Isn't it true that you've made some unwise decisions? And I know this is true because I've made some unwise decisions, and I had all the information. I had all the information available on that particular topic, but I just made a bad, unwise decision. And isn't it true that you look at some of your decisions that you've made that you wish you hadn't made, and you go, no, I had all the information, but I just made a bad decision. In fact, we live in the information age. We live in the age of information. In fact, I'm even told there is a superhighway of information that you can cruise on. An information superhighway. It's amazing. Perhaps you've heard of this. There's also something now called artificial intelligence. ChatGPT. Here's what's so amazing about ChatGPT. I can go to ChatGPT and say, give me a great talk, give me a great sermon or a message on wisdom. And I wanted to include an illustration that has something from the Rolling Stones and Chewbacca and driving a Prius. And it will spit it out. In 25 seconds, it will spit out a full, incredible message written. It'll include an illustration about those three things, and it'll sound like it was written by me. I mean, that freaks me out, because I've seen The Matrix, okay? I know how this story ends. The computers learn us, they take over, we're all dead. End of story. Artificial intelligence is information, but it is not wisdom. There's a big difference. And some of you are very smart people, and you have tons of information. But you go, but why have I made so many unwise decisions? Because information is not wisdom. You don't think about how to navigate the world in order to produce a life that flourishes and doesn't flounder. And so there are decisions that you've made that you regret. And there are decisions that I've made that I regret. And it was not a lack of information that led me to that experience. It wasn't a lack of information that caused me to make unwise decisions. Because if I could give you the simplest, the very, very simplest definition of wisdom that I could come up with, it's this. Wisdom is simply living life as if it is connected. It's simply living life as if it's connected. It's connecting the dots between the decisions I make now and how they impact me later. Living life as if it's connected, because it is. A connects to B, B connects to C. Every decision that you make, it is not simply a decision in the moment, it is a path that leads to a destination. We've got to understand this. Everyone ends up somewhere. Very few people do it on purpose. And the truth is, most people in our culture today, they don't plan to mess up their lives. They just don't plan not to. And what ends up happening is, for many of us, life becomes like throwing darts at a dartboard and hoping we hit the right thing. And life is just very reactive and not very proactive. But wisdom, at its very simplest, is simply connecting the dots, understanding the correct path to take, understanding that my choices today affect my future reality. And folks, without wisdom, we act like life is a total mystery, don't we? It's like we make a choice and we think, oh, it's just a decision in the moment, but it's actually leading me on a path that leads to a destination. And then I end up at the inevitable destination of where that path leads. And I go, well, how'd I get here? This isn't where I wanted to be. This isn't where I wanted to end up. What in the world? And then we blame other people and we blame God. And the truth is, we just haven't connected the dots that I put myself on a trajectory that was heading down that path a long time ago. That's wisdom. My current choices will create my future reality. All through the scriptures, specifically when we read what we're going to read today through Proverbs and Psalms, and these are the wisdom of Solomon. And Solomon was a guy that had incredible wisdom as a gift from God. In fact, he was so wise, and he would write down these proverbs. And the truth is, When we read some of these things, every time that Solomon talks about decisions that we make, he uses words like walk, he uses words like run, he uses words like path, road. He talks about life as if it's this journey that we're traveling on, and walking and running and taking paths and roads is the way that he talks about decisions, that wise decisions will take you down a specific path, and unwise decisions will take you down another path. But the whole idea, the whole concept is that life isn't lived in a vacuum, that I don't make a decision today that doesn't put me on a path towards somewhere tomorrow. And wisdom, at its simplest, is just understanding that life is connected. The wise person connects the dots. The fool just says, I don't know how I ended up here, and acts like life is a mystery. And so, in some of the Proverbs, Proverbs chapter 4, this is Solomon writing. Solomon had wisdom that comes from God. He says this: if you live a life guided by wisdom, you won't limp or stumble as you run. Now, God created us to walk this path called life, and he wants us to live a flourishing life. God wants us to thrive in life. And yet, without wisdom, Solomon says, it's like for many of us, because of the choices we've made, we're limping through life. And maybe some of you are limping in here this morning. Maybe you're limping along in your marriage, or you're limping along in a career, or you're limping along in a relationship with kids, or you're limping along in your finances, or you're limping along in just your relationship with God. You have a limping soul. And you're just going, man, I don't know. It feels like I'm trying to get through it, but it's difficult. It's like I'm walking with a limp. And it's possible, and I'm not saying this for sure, but it's possible that there's some decisions that we've made in our past that we recognize have led to this point. Now, there's some good news and some bad news. Here's the bad news. Unless you own a time machine, you can't change the past. Unless you can get into a phone booth with Bill and Ted. Unless you can jump into a DeLorean, you cannot go back and erase the past. That part is done. Now, here's the good news. The good news is you can start today. Regardless of what choices you've made in the past, God wants to redeem your choices. God wants to give you wisdom for moving forward. And here's what's amazing about this. It's never too late to start down a new path because God does not work with what should have been. God works with what is. And he's way more concerned with your future than he is with your past. And you need to know that. And so that's really good news. That means that no matter where I find myself today, I can start today. I can start down the road less stupid today. So for the next several weeks, as we lead up to Memorial Day, we're going to walk through different areas of our lives and apply God's wisdom to marriage, parenting, friendships, the workplace, how we spend our time, how we spend our money, all of these different things, and go, what would it look like to submit those areas of my life to God's wisdom? Today, we're introducing, what is wisdom to begin with? How do I get there? How do I think about wisdom? And so let's walk through a few principles today that will help us. Number one, evaluate the direction your life is headed. It starts with just this honest question of going, do I like the direction my life is headed? Right? If life is a series of decisions and my decisions are paths that lead me to a destination, then I have to ask myself, do I like that destination? More importantly, is that somewhere that I actually want to end up? Is that my preferred future? Is that what I want my life to look like? And we've got a couple of ways of measuring that in our culture that have really not helped us. One of the ways that we measure that in our culture and evaluate is with this question. Is there anything wrong with it? And can I just tell you, that is a horrible question to ask. Because here's what we do. Okay, is there a Bible verse that says I shouldn't? Is there a thou shalt not that I'm ignoring somewhere along the way? Like, God, there's nothing specifically in the Bible that says thou shalt not, so we just assume that if there's nothing wrong with it, then it must be the wise thing for me to do. And here's what I can tell you about me. Any experience that I've had where I regret the decision that I've made, I justified it. The sales associate in my head said, hey, there's nothing wrong with it. Oh, great. And the assumption is, if there's nothing wrong with it, then it must be the right thing to do. And that is a horrible way to evaluate the direction that our life is headed. Just because there's nothing wrong with it, it doesn't mean that it's moving you toward your preferred future. We have to start thinking differently about how we evaluate our lives. Otherwise, we tend to repeat this unhealthy pattern. I love one of my all-time favorite Proverbs that King Solomon writes. It's written nearly 3,000 years ago. He says this, a prudent person, or that's a way of saying a wise person, foresees danger, and takes precautions. So a prudent person or a wise person, they're looking down the path that they're on, they see danger, and they take precaution. And they go, hey, life is connected. If this is the path I'm on and I see danger down the road, I should do something about it now to prepare myself. By contrast, he says, the simpleton goes blindly on and suffers the consequences. The simpleton, which is a nice way of saying the fool, just looks down the road, sees the same danger, and goes, it'll work itself out. I don't have to do anything about that. I'm sure by the time we get there, everything will be fine. Lives as if life is disconnected. And all through the scriptures, what you find is that is a foolish way to live your life. My son Liam, when he was about 6 years old, came downstairs one day, and I'll never forget this, and he comes downstairs, and he's wearing some new sweatpants that we got him, and we go, cool sweatpants, dude. And he goes, thanks. He goes, Dad, I have 6 pairs of shorts on underneath. I said, whoa, okay. Why do you have 6 pairs of shorts on underneath? And he goes, if anybody tries to punch me in the leg, I'll be ready. He was pretty proud of himself, and I just went, it caused a little bit of alarm in me, and I just led to my next question. I said, hey, buddy, is someone punching you in the leg? And he goes, no, but if they do, I'll be ready. And I was like, yes, you will. Wisdom suggests that you look down the path, and if there is danger there, that you prepare for it. And you got to ask yourself this question, do I want to end up where this path is leading? And if the answer is no, wisdom would suggest that you take action. And again, we've got a couple of ways that we measure and sort of evaluate this in our culture that aren't helping us. Another one is this: we compare ourselves to other people. Instead of asking, is this path leading to a destination that I want to be at? We go, well, I mean, I'm kind of further along than that person. I'm not as far along as this person. We compare ourselves to others. But here's a much better question. When it comes to your marriage, do you want your marriage to look like everybody else? Like, who are you comparing yourself to? Who are you evaluating against? When it comes to finances, do I want it to look like everyone else in our culture? When it comes to parenting, do I want it to look like everyone else in our culture? When it comes to generosity, do I want it to look like everyone else in our culture? Do I just want to measure and go, well, these are best practices, this is the norm, this is how just culture does things, and I guess I'm right in line with that? Do you just want to kind of pick up your feet and let the current of culture take you wherever it will? Or do we say something different? Do we evaluate the direction life is headed and ask a different question? Not, is there anything wrong with it? Not how am I doing against everybody else, but what do I want my future self to look like in this area? And what path do I need to be on that's going to lead to that destination? That is wisdom. It's living life like it's connected. And then secondly, here's what we need to do. We need to admit our need for God's wisdom. It would make sense that if God is the author of life, that he knows how life ought to be best lived. And this is what's so amazing about this. Wisdom at its core is this act of humility, because it begins with the acknowledgement, there might be something that I don't know. It's an act of humility that says, there's something that God knows that I don't know, that God's God and I'm not. And in order to do that, you have to admit you don't know everything. And do you know what we all already acknowledged? Because we all lifted our hands when we said, hey, there's some stuff I wish I hadn't said and wish I hadn't did and wish I hadn't spent. We all acknowledged there's times in our life where we don't know what's best for me. There's times in my life where I don't know what's best for myself. And if your cup is full, there's no room for anything else. Pride keeps me from learning things that I don't know. It keeps me from gaining wisdom that would benefit me. Pride allows me to smuggle my own issues into my next season of life, and it sets me up for a repeat performance. And so, this is exactly why Solomon would write these words in Proverbs. He says, "Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom." Do you want to know where wisdom begins? Do you want to know how to live like life is connected? You fear the Lord. Now, this word fear, sometimes this gets kind of misinterpreted and taken out of context. He's not saying like, oh my, I'm just so terrified God's going to strike me down. There is such a thing as healthy fear. Healthy fear is why we look both ways before we cross the street, right? Healthy fear is why we don't play with rattlesnakes, right? Healthy fear is why we respect our parents. We understand the role that they play in our lives. It's simply this understanding of our appropriate position in the universe, right? And when Solomon uses the word fear, it's in that exact context. It's the fear that says, I recognize God is the author of life, and he knows how life is best to be lived. And so I'm gonna recognize you're God and I'm not. I'm human, I'm finite, you're God, you're infinite. So I won't assume that I know better. And Solomon says that acknowledgement is where wisdom begins. That's where wisdom is born. It's this act of humility. It's this acknowledgement of my appropriate position in the universe in relation to God. Without that, we have this tendency to set ourselves up as God, make our own decisions, and then we're stunned when we make unwise decisions. How is that working out for us? Not very well, right? We've all already admitted that we don't always know what's best. We all already admitted that the sales associate in our own heads has closed the deal on a number of sales. In fact, one time the Rolling Stones were picked up in a Prius by Chewbacca. Shoot, that's not supposed to be in there. Okay, sorry about that. Not sure what happened. Proverbs, Solomon writes this: there is a path before each person that seems right, but it ends in death. Haven't we all experienced that before? Haven't we all said those words before? It seemed right in the moment. I mean, I started down this path and it sure seemed right in the moment, but then I don't know what happened. It didn't end the way that I thought it would end. How many times have we said that? Well, it seemed like the right thing to do. It seemed like the right thing to say. It seemed like the right decision in the moment. And Solomon says, there's a way that seems right to us, but it ends in death. And some of us have experienced that. Death of a relationship. Death of a reputation. Death of an opportunity. Some of us have experienced that in a real way that we go, it seemed like the right thing to do, but man, it actually caused a lot more turmoil and a lot more stress, and it actually caused a lot of difficulty in my life. and I've got regret. And man, how is that possible when it seemed so good in the moment? It's because we have this tendency to go, well, I'm just going to follow my heart. We become emotionally attached to something down a path, and we chase that thing. And man, if I had a dime for every time I heard someone say, well, I just decided to follow my heart on this one. I think it's one of the worst decision-making processes we could go through, because we don't always make the wisest decisions for ourselves in the long run. And every single time that I've walked down the wrong path, it was because I was following my heart. It's because I was emotionally attached to something down this path. And everything in wisdom was saying, this is the path you want to be on. But everything emotionally was saying, yeah, but I really like something over here. So I think I'm going to go with that. And I go, well, I know wisdom says this, but there's nothing wrong with this. There's nothing wrong with it. Yeah, I know that, but this is how everybody in culture does it. And I think I'm going to fit better over here. And I chase something down that path. And I become attached to something and fail to admit that I actually need God's wisdom and not my own. And so, the first thing I need is admit I'm in need of God's guidance. I'm in need of God's wisdom. I may not always know what's best for me. And the good news is this, God really wants to give you his wisdom. James, the brother of Jesus, would write a letter to followers of Jesus in the first century, and here's what he says. He says, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God. That's such a great concept. If you want wisdom, if you recognize you need wisdom, and you think God's got wisdom, why not ask him? If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. If you are lacking wisdom, it's God wants to give you his wisdom if you'll simply ask. And so we've got to evaluate the direction our life is headed, acknowledge that we need God's wisdom, just admit, God, you're God and I'm not. That's where wisdom begins. And then, number three, just take your next right step. See, it's one thing to look at your life, evaluate the direction your life is headed, and then realize, God, I need your wisdom. Will you please give me your wisdom? And God says, yep, I'm going to give you my wisdom. But if we don't actually respond to it, if we say, okay, thanks for the wisdom, I'm going to do my own thing anyways, then it doesn't really help us at all. Well, what if I'm new to this whole thing? What if I really don't know much about the Bible? What if I don't know much about God? What if I'm just learning? The difference between knowledge and wisdom is applying the facts that you know, applying what you already know. It's just taking one next right step in the parts that you do know. It's not about knowing everything. It's about responding to what you do. It's not about perfection. It's about progress. Wisdom is applying the parts that you do know to your daily life. I love this quote from Mark Twain. Mark Twain once said this, "Most people are bothered by those passages of Scripture which they cannot understand. The Scripture which troubles me the most is the Scripture I do understand." He goes, the stuff I don't understand, that seems to bother people. He goes, that doesn't bother me because I don't understand it. But the parts that really bother me are the parts I do understand. Like God's going, this is what I want you to do. And I was like, oh, I don't really want to do that. And here's something that I've learned from being a pastor. And this happens occasionally where someone will come to me and they'll go, I really need to talk with you. I need some counsel or some wisdom or some guidance. And then I'll sit down and I'll talk with them. And every once in a while, what happens is this. They're really not looking for wisdom or counsel or guidance. They really are looking for confirmation for a decision that they've already decided to do. Like, I really want to do this, but I'm not sure. Is there a verse you can give me that will really just help me feel better about what I really know is an unwise decision, but at the end of the day, I really want to do it. So can you just confirm something for me? Help me know that I'm not going to feel guilty about it? And there's that doesn't bother me. You know why? Because I do the same thing with God. I do. We approach God the same way. We want God to be like this sort of cosmic life coach or like a consultant. And I'm like, hey, God, I'm really thinking about doing this. And God's just shining a light going, that's really unwise. And I'm going, that's not really what I hired you for. So hold on. I'll get back to you. I'm going to pursue some other things here. But here's what's amazing. God is not our consultant. God doesn't work for us. And the problem is we're looking for God to confirm an unwise decision that we've already decided that we're going to make. And we're just hoping we can feel a little less guilty about it. Again, this is from the Psalms. This is King David writing this, and I love what he writes. He says, your instructions give me understanding. I start to understand life once I start to look into your instructions. No wonder I hate every false way of life. When I follow your instructions, it's like you're showing me the way to live because you're the author of life, and I can trust that your way of living is the best. So I'm starting to hate any of the false paths that I've been down. And then he says, your word is a lamp to guide my feet and a light for my path. It's like you illuminate the path that I should take. And when I start to follow that, it just becomes more and more clear. Not too long ago, I was driving one of my kids home and noticed that my lights were pretty dim. And got home and I realized I was a padiddle. And if you don't know what a padiddle is, it's a good excuse to slug one of your siblings when you're riding in a car with mom and dad. And it's a car with one headlight out, right? And so I was driving home and I was like, man, these things are dim. And I knew they were dim and I was kind of driving like that for a couple days. I got to make an appointment. I got to get this fixed. And then my wife borrowed my car and she's like, your headlight is so dim, I can hardly see anything. And it was like, you know, late afternoon. It wasn't, you know, dark yet. And I was like, yeah, I know. It's a padiddle. I got to get it fixed. And so I was picking up another kid from something later that night, and it was nighttime, and it was dark. And I'm driving down the road, and I'm going, I can't see anything. And I actually pulled over and realized I'm a double padiddle. I have no headlights. I learned that that's called a blackout. And so the rest of the way, I was like, oh, this is not good. So I had to drive with my high beams on, which I can tell you, it makes you the most beloved person on the road. And I knew it too because everybody was like flashing their brights at me and I could feel the support. It felt really good to know that everyone was cheering me on, you know? And now I know, like if I ever see another padiddle and I'm like flicking my lights at them, they might actually be a blackout. If they're driving with their high beams on, it's possible they actually just don't have any headlights, and I'll have a little more grace for them. But what's amazing is, and I did get them fixed the next day, just the end of the story there, full disclosure, but the truth is, it's really difficult to drive when you can't see. It's really difficult to know where you're going in the dark. And this is the point that David is making. King David is saying, look, God's given us a lot of wisdom in the scriptures. But if we just go, well, I don't really know that much about the Bible, and that makes it difficult. For most of us, our unwise decisions are not a lack of information. They're a lack of obedience. We know what God says in that area of our lives. We just don't want to do it. We know where God's shining a light on that path. We just don't want to walk down that path. And in fact, most of us have more information than we're currently obeying. Isn't that true? The question is, what part do you know? Because when we respond in obedience to the parts that we do know, to the wisdom that we do have, to the light that God has given us, then God gives us more. This is the way that King Solomon would write this in the Proverbs. He says, the way of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn, which shines ever brighter until the full light of day. If anybody else was up this morning to see the sunrise this morning, amazing. We were driving into church this morning, and my son took a picture of it with my phone because he's just like, this is unbelievable. Dad, where's your phone? I got to capture this. It was an unbelievable sunrise, and it just got brighter and brighter and brighter and brighter. And this is what Solomon is saying. For those of us that say, okay, God, I'm going to follow your way, it's like I take that next right step, and God's kind of shining a light right here, and I take that next right step, and then God turns the lights up a little bit. It's like, oh, okay, I see the path a little more clearly. I'm going to take another step. And it's like the lights just get brighter and brighter and brighter until it's the fullness of day and we can see clearly what God wants us to do. And then Solomon contrasts that. He says, but the way of the wicked is like complete darkness. And those who follow it have no idea what they're stumbling over. It's like God's illuminating something here, but we're over here in the darkness. And God's going, no, here's the path to take. We go, yeah, but I'm following my heart over here into the darkness, and I can't even see what I'm stumbling over. And the more you walk down the path of God's wisdom, the clearer the whole picture becomes. It becomes easier to see which path to take. And when you ignore God's wisdom, and God says, I'm shining a light on it, and you go, yeah, thanks, but no thanks. I can do this myself. In favor of going down your own path, it becomes more and more difficult to see which path to take. And oftentimes, this has been my experience. I do this myself. People come to me and have these questions. Oftentimes what happens is, when I'm stumbling around in the dark and God's going, look, I just want you to be generous with what I've entrusted to you. I just want you to start there and learn that. Hey, you know what? I just want you to forgive that person who hurt you. If you could just make it right with them, that's your next right step. You know what? I just want you to love your neighbor well. And this is where I'm shining a light right here. This is your next right step. Hey, you know what? I'd love for you to get connected in community because it will really help you as you move forward in life. This is your next right step. And then we're over here in this path in the dark going, okay, God, I got a deep theological question. If you could just, I think we really need to spend some time studying Revelation and end times questions and figure out like what's going to happen at the end of the world. And we don't even see what we're stumbling over. And God's going, I just want you to love your neighbor well. Yeah, I'm going to get to that, God, but I got this deep theological question. Until I get this answered, I'm not so sure I can do that. And this is exactly what Solomon is saying. The way of the righteous is like one step of the other. It's like the light gets turned on more and more and more. But when we ignore God's clear wisdom in favor of chasing down our own path, it's like we don't even know what we're stumbling over. Content doesn't affect your life until it becomes conduct. What are you doing with what you know? Are you putting it into practice? And if anybody had the ability to depend on their own understanding and their own wisdom and their own knowledge, it was Solomon. He had more wisdom, more knowledge on various topics than anyone who ever lived. Kings and queens would travel from other kingdoms and nations to hear about him, to sit at his feet and talk about all kinds of different topics. And yet, here's what Solomon writes. He would say this, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't just follow your heart. You entrust your Heavenly Father with your heart. You entrust your Heavenly Father with the emotions and the things that you're feeling. You don't just follow your heart. You trust your Heavenly Father with your heart. He would say, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and do not depend on your own understanding. In other words, you've got some understanding. And if anybody had understanding, it was Solomon. And here's the contrast that Solomon's creating. When your understanding bumps into God's ways, wisdom would suggest that you go with God's ways. Whatever you're understanding relationally, God knows best. Whatever you're understanding financially, God knows best. Whatever you're understanding for your career, God knows best. When it comes to marriage, when it comes to parenting, when it comes to friendship, when it comes to how you spend your time, how you spend your resources, God knows best. God, I'm willing to allow your way to trump my understanding. And it's not that you don't have understanding. That's the whole point. It's just that sometimes our understanding is flawed at best. It's the same reason that a 2-year-old or a 5-year-old has a certain level of understanding, but not the same understanding as the parent. And you're trying to help them understand, but you're going, hey, listen, don't depend just on everything on your experience. I have a different vantage point. And when it comes to us and God, Solomon would say, don't depend on your own understanding. Yeah, but I got 30 years experience in this field. Okay. But in relation to God, maybe it would be wise to go with God's command. Whenever your understanding bumps into God's ways, wisdom would suggest you go with God's ways. Solomon says, seek his will in all you do. Now, this is originally written in Hebrew, and so when you translate this into modern English, this phrase, in all you do, actually means in all you do. It's pretty clear. In every arena of life, if you will seek God's will, if you'll say, okay, I've got some understanding in this area, God, but I want to, what do you say? Here's the promise, that he will show you which path to take. There's that language again. If you'll not depend on your understanding, but if you'll instead acknowledge him and his role in the universe, that's the beginning of wisdom. And then if you'll say, okay, God, I want to seek your will. In everything I do, in every arena of life, what do you say? He'll show you which path to take. You'll know you're on the right path. When we come to a fork in the road and we have a decision before us, before we launch down the path of least resistance, before we follow our heart down a path of something we're emotionally attached to and find ourselves stumbling in the dark, if we would pause and surrender whatever our understanding, whatever our experience, whatever information we have and go, God, what do you say about this? And whatever we believe God is saying to us about that, wherever God's shining the light, if we would do that, we can know with assurance we're on the right path. And then, this is super important, surround yourself with fellow travelers. Folks, don't do this alone, right? Oftentimes, the difference between knowing something and doing something is the people with whom you choose to surround yourself. That's why workout classes, group workout classes and gyms are so popular. It's why CrossFit is so popular. And if you don't know someone who does CrossFit, just give it time. They will let you know. That's why we do groups. Because relationships are what give traction to our belief system. It's one thing to believe something, but to do it, we need some other people who are traveling in the same direction that we are spiritually. But we are more likely to give and serve and love and grow and forgive others when we're moving in the same spiritual direction as other people, when we're not doing it on our own. That's why, again, in the New Testament, the author of Hebrews is writing to a group of people living in the first century who are following Jesus. And the author of Hebrews would put these words on the pages. Let us think of ways to motivate one another. Let's think of ways, let's get inspired by each other. Let's think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. And let us not neglect our meeting together, but encourage one another. Now, this is not talking about like Sunday morning services, like you better go to church. That's not what the author's talking about. They're saying, let's not stop getting together with other people who are moving in the same direction that we are spiritually, where we know each other eyeball to eyeball, where we can motivate one another and encourage one another. And the word encourage, all it means is to instill courage. And don't we all need that? I do. I need somebody else sometimes to instill courage into me to do the thing that I already know God's asking me to do, but I don't want to do it. And this is the reason that we're constantly encouraging you to join a group, because being around other people of faith will help you to walk out your faith. We encourage each other to take the right paths. Now, before we close, let me say this. Knowing and doing are two completely different experiences with two completely different outcomes. And we know that's true, don't we? And unfortunately, oftentimes we use the one to justify the fact that we ignore the other. Let me put it in a way that illustrate in a way we can understand. You know this is true if you've ever been a kid or if you have kids. You've had this conversation either with your parents or as a parent, you've had this conversation with your kids. Hey, listen, son, I need you to, dad. I know. You don't even need to say it. I had that conversation with my parents 100 times as a teenager. Hey, listen, Jeremiah, we're gonna need you, dad, I know. You don't even need to say it. Hey, son, daughter, hey, Chloe, Kaylee, hey, listen, I need you, dad, I know. You don't even need to say it. The assumption is knowing is enough. And since I know, I'll do. And here's what we know. That's just not true. I thought you said you knew. Yeah, I know. Well, then why didn't you do? And we do this all the time. Knowing is information. Doing is wisdom. In fact, James, the brother of Jesus, would put it in these terms. He says this, don't just listen to God's word, do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves. He says, you're living like a fool. You're tricking yourself into thinking that life is disconnected, and it's not. So here's the question all of us should wrestle with today. What do you know you need to do, but you just aren't doing it? What do you know? What do you know you need to do? It's like wisdom says it. God's just shining a light on it right here, but you're stumbling around in the dark over here. And God's going, no. I just, here's what I want. This is your next right step. It's not about perfection. It's just about progress. I just want you to take one next right step, and then I'm going to keep turning the light up and bringing more and more clarity to the path that I want you on. But what is it that you know you need to do, but you just aren't doing it? What do you know you need to start and you haven't? What do you know you need to stop and you haven't? What relationship do you need to reconcile and you haven't? And every once in a while, someone who loves you sees it and says, hey, you know, you really ought to. And you go, don't even say it. I know you don't even have to say it. And then you don't do it. And I don't do it. And why do we do that? And if you know what to do and you refuse to do it, if you know exactly what you ought to do and it's clear and God's shining a light in this area of your life and you refuse to do it, in Jesus' words, these aren't my words, in the words of Solomon, in the words of King David, in the words of Jesus, in the words of James, the brother of Jesus, you're a fool. You're fooling yourself into believing that life is not connected. So why not do it? And why not do it today? You'll be glad you did, because you will. And here's what you're invited into. If you're considering, if you're wondering, you know, about submitting your life to the God who created you, is God really the author of life? This is what's so amazing. For God to instill this in us so that we could get this, he didn't just shout down a bunch more rules and shout down a bunch more laws and give us a bunch more commandments. Instead, he sent his son to show us how to live it out. So Jesus came into the world. He became flesh and blood And then he showed us what God is like. He showed us how to live. He showed us how to love. In the ultimate expression of love, he allowed himself to be put to death. His body was laid in a tomb. And according to multiple eyewitness accounts, Jesus rose from the dead. And here's what that means. Death is not the end. There's more to this life than this life. And you and I have been invited by the God who created us and loves us. He is for us. And he wants a good life for us. So it would make sense that if he is for us and if he loves us, that we would submit our lives to his wisdom and to his ways. And if you've never said yes to the invitation to be a part of God's family, you should know, you don't behave your way in. This isn't about like if I live, you know, if I follow him, then I can get in. It's totally the opposite. God says, just start following me. And as you start to follow me, then things will become more and more clear. And if you've never said yes to that, I want to invite you to say yes by just agreeing with this simple prayer as we close. God, please forgive my sins. Forgive me for the times that I've walked away from you. I'm so grateful you never walk away from me. And so I want to say yes to your invitation. Make me your son. Make me your daughter. And just help me. As I follow you, help me to see wisdom. Help me to see your ways. Help me to acknowledge your ways. And God, I pray for every one of us who follow you each day. It's so tempting for us to just follow our hearts instead of following you and your wisdom. And so I pray that we wouldn't fall into the trap of just follow your heart, but that we would entrust our Heavenly Father with our heart. God, that we would entrust you with our heart and that we would follow your ways and your wisdom because you are for us and you want good for us. And as we do that, may our lives point to the goodness and grace of Jesus. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jeremiah. So here.